Good morning, everyone, and welcome to this RFF live event, Unplugging Emissions, Exploring New EPA Rules on Climate and Health. I'm Karen Palmer, Senior Fellow and Director of the Electric Power Program at Resources for the Future, a nonprofit research institute that improves environmental, energy, and natural resource decisions through impartial economic research and policy engagement. Thank you for joining us. Today, we're here to examine three new power sector regulations from the Environmental Protection Agency. Namely, the Good Neighbor Plan for 2015 Ozone NAAQS, a new proposed mercury and air toxic standard residual risk and technology review, and a proposed rule for regulating carbon emissions from existing and new power plants under Section 111 of the Clean Air Act, a replacement for the Obama administration's Clean Power Plan and the Trump administration's Affordable Clean Energy Rule. To help us unpack these regulations, I'm joined by a wonderful panel of experts, including Chris Hoagland, who's the Director of Air and Radiation at the Maryland Department of the Environment, Elsie Sunderland, who's the Gordon McKay Professor of Environmental Chemistry at Harvard University, and Carrie Jenks, who's the Executive Director of the Environmental and Energy Law Program at Harvard Law School. So in this event today, I'm going to begin by providing some context about the new regulatory landscape and the policy goals driving the new push from EPA. Then we'll turn to Chris to provide us with an overview of the final Good Neighbor Rule, which aims to reduce cross-border pollution from power plants. After that, Elsie will discuss the proposed Mercury and Air Toxics Standard, or MATS, which sets limits on hazardous pollutants. Finally, we'll turn to Carrie to explore last week's proposed regulation limiting CO2 emissions under Section 111 of the Clean Air Act, previous attempts at which have faced serious legal challenges. After each of these presentations, and we hear from each panelist, we're going to open it up for the whole panel for a moderated discussion. A few housekeeping notes before we get started. This is a public webinar. It's being recorded and it will be posted on our website afterwards. As time allows, we will open the webinar to audience Q&A at the end of the session. I encourage you to submit your questions at any point in the webinar to the Q&A box, which is located at the bottom of your screen. We'll be monitoring those questions and we'll try to get to as many as we can. Lastly, if you'd like to join the conversation on Twitter, please use the hashtag RFFLive. With that, I'm going to dive in here with some background. So it's definitely been a productive spring for the staff at the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency with these three rules coming out in rapid succession. So I want to provide just a little bit of history on each of them. First is the Good Neighbor Plan released by EPA on the 15th of March. This final rule is a continuation in a line of rules to address out-of-state emissions that impact downwind states' abilities to reach attainment with the national ambient air quality standards for ozone, as well as other pollutants, as specified in Section 110 of the Clean Air Act. One notable example of a prior Good Neighbor Rule is the Cross-State Air Pollution Rule issued in 2011. The Cross-State Rule, or CASPER, as it can be affectionately referred to, program focused on electricity generators, while the new Good Neighbor Plan also includes industrial sources in some states. And it's the first to focus on the 2015 Ozone NAAQS, and it specifically targets states that impact air quality in states that are in moderate or severe non-attainment. We'll hear more about this new rule in a minute from Chris Hoagland from the Maryland Department of the Environment. The second of the three rules is the new proposed Mercury and Air Toxic Standards, or MATS, Residual Risk and Technology Review, and it was issued by EPA on April 5th. This rule is proposed under Section 112 of the Clean Air Act, which requires EPA to regulate major stationary sources like power plants that emit hazardous air pollutants over a certain threshold. In addition, once compliance with existing standards has been attained, the law requires EPA to periodically review what residual risks remain that might make it desirable to strengthen the standards, and to assess if there are new technologies or practices that could be deployed to reduce emissions. These combined assessments are referred to as the Residual Risk and Technology Review. Importantly, before EPA can set attainment standards under Section 112 of the Clean Air Act, it must first make an explicit determination about whether it is appropriate and necessary to regulate electric generating units in this way. EPA's April 5th proposal falls on the heels of a new determination by EPA a month prior that it is indeed appropriate and necessary for EPA to regulate hazardous air pollutants from coal and oil-fired power plants. This appropriate and necessary ruling revoked a 2020 ruling by the Trump administration EPA that concluded the opposite. So we'll hear more about this new MATS rule from and its implications for the environment from Elsie Sunderland from the Department of Environmental Health at Harvard. The third rule is a proposed rule for regulating carbon emissions from existing and new power plants under Section 111 of the Clean Air Act, a replacement for the Obama administration's Clean Power Plan and the Trump administration's Affordable Clean Energy Rule. Take a breath. Truly a mouthful in need of a pithy name, so something we should all consider as we prepare comments on the proposed rule. This new proposal is the third in a line of regulations proposed by EPA to carry out its obligation to regulate greenhouse gas emissions from electricity providers. The history here goes back nearly 16 years or more maybe, but in 2007, the Supreme Court ruled in its Massachusetts EPA versus EPA case that greenhouse gases are air pollutants under the Clean Air Act and that EPA must determine if these pollutants endanger public health or welfare. In 2009, the EPA finalized its finding under Section 202A of the Clean Air Act that greenhouse gases in the atmosphere are a danger to public health and the environment. And this finding, the so-called endangerment finding, meant that EPA was obligated to regulate greenhouse gas emissions. Between 2009 and 2014, there was much discussion in many settings about what sections of the Clean Air Act could be used to regulate greenhouse gas emissions and what regulatory approach each section of the act might support. In June of 2014, the speculation ended when EPA issued a proposed rule known as the Clean Power Plan to use Section 111 of the Clean Air Act to regulate greenhouse gas emissions. In that proposed rule, EPA did two things. One was set emissions guidelines for electricity generating unit sources of greenhouse gas emissions based on the best system of emissions reductions, and two, set forth the requirements and flexibilities for states as they develop their plans for compliance with the rule. In this proposal, EPA used a system-wide approach to specify the emissions guidelines, and its guidance on state plans indicated that states could use emissions trading of various types for compliance. In August of 2015, EPA issued its final Clean Power Plan regulation, which was then stayed by the Supreme Court in February of 2016 and never went into effect. Then in summer of 2019, the Trump administration rescinded the Clean Power Plan and replaced it with the Affordable Clean Energy, or ACE rule, which sets standards for existing coal-fired generators based on emissions reductions that could be achieved with efficiency enhancements at individual power plants. The ACE rule was vacated by the U.S. Court of Appeals for the District of Columbia in January of 2021 on the basis that the EPA was too limited in its interpretation of what types of measures could be imposed under the law. However, in June of 2022, in West Virginia versus EPA, the Supreme Court reversed the appeals court on ACE and found that the Clean Power Plan represented a violation of the major questions doctrine that relegates major questions of policy to Congress. At the same time, the ACE rule was indirectly reinstated by the DC Circuit Court, which placed the case challenging the ACE rule in abeyance. And however, the ACE rule was rescinded as a part of the new proposal that we're gonna hear about today from Carrie Jenks in a little bit. Now, one more thing by way of background is the set of rules that we consider today, one final and two proposed, come less than a year after the Congress passed the Inflation Reduction Act, a law that uses tax policies and other subsidies to promote a major shift in how our country produces and consumes electricity over the next decade and beyond. While the IRA promises major reductions in CO2 and other pollutants, it does not directly address emissions from fossil generators, leaving that task to regulators. So the rules we're going to talk about today cover three types of power sector emissions, and the development of these rules takes into account specific features of the IRA, including tax credits, federal funding for hydrogen production, carbon capture, utilization, storage, renewable energy production, and infrastructure. So now, without any further ado, I'm going to turn the floor over to Chris Hoagland to talk about the good neighbor rule. So take it away, Chris.
Thanks very much, Karen, and thanks for having me. So I'm Chris Hoagland. I'm the air director at the Maryland Department of the Environment. And Karen, can you see my screen okay? I'll be talking about the good neighbor, good neighbor federal implementation plan, which, as Karen described, is a program primarily focused on reducing ground level ozone by addressing emissions of ozone forming pollution that cross state lines, specifically one of the primary ozone forming pollutants, nitrogen oxides or NOx. So I'll give a little bit about why the rule is important, what the rule does, and Maryland's perspective on the Good Neighbor FIP. So first, why is the Good Neighbor FIP important? To exemplify this, I'm going to talk about what caused a bad ozone day here in Maryland 2 years ago today on May 19th, 2021. When we have bad ozone days in Maryland, we can look at what happened on those days to try to figure out why that happened. We do this analysis very frequently on bad air pollution days. And the first thing we do is we use meteorological data to determine where did the air that we were breathing here in Maryland come from on that day. And you're seeing that in the map on the right. This is showing various trajectories that the air mass that ended up in Maryland, specifically in Edgewood, Maryland, where we have a monitor that was measuring ozone levels above the standard of 70 parts per billion on that day. Where did all the air that ended up in Edgewood, Maryland come from over the preceding day and preceding 2 days? And that's the map on the right. And then on the left, we can look along those air mass trajectories and figure out where did the ozone forming pollution come from? Where was it emitted along those trajectories? What were the sources that caused the air pollution that subsequently Marylanders had to breathe? And the bar graphs, the column graphs on the left here show emissions, tons of NOx emitted by specifically power plants along that back trajectory, color-coded by state. And we have showing three clusters here, emissions the day of the ozone exceedance, emissions the day before along the trajectory, and emissions 2 days before along the trajectory. And for each of those categories, we're showing here how much NOx was actually emitted from power plants in the first bar. In the middle one, we're showing how much lower that NOx would have been had those power plants who already have existing pollution controls installed at the facilities, had they optimized the use of those controls. And then the third graph, the third bar, the one pointing downward, is what the reductions would have been, the difference between those two things. How much lower would NOx have been? What are the reductions we would have enjoyed had just the existing pollution controls installed, had those power plants been optimized? And we do this frequently, and we see over and over and over again when we analyze these high pollution days in Maryland, we see a couple of things. First, Maryland's power plants are relatively small contributors to the ozone forming pollution that causes high ozone in Maryland. On the graph, Maryland is sort of the light blue area, and you can see that we're pretty small. The power plants in Maryland are pretty small compared to all of the pollution being emitted upwind in other states. And the second thing we see is that had existing controls been optimized in those upwind power plants, it would have made a big difference. On many days, including this one when the Edgewood monitor was just slightly above the standard, that optimization, that reduction of pollution easily would have been enough to bring ozone levels in Maryland down below the standard. Another way to think of that is that the failure of upwind states to require sufficient control in their pollution sources is what is causing the unhealthy air in Maryland. And Maryland's not alone in that. Lots of different states experience that. We struggle to meet our air quality standards because the air coming into our states from upwind is already so full of pollution that it's going to exceed the standard. And that's not supposed to happen. It's not supposed to be that way. Under the Clean Air Act, it requires all the states to be good neighbors. We're not supposed to be causing non-attainment in our neighboring states and in our downwind states. And so the Good Neighbor FIP, the Good Neighbor Federal Implementation Plan, is a measure to address that problem, to require us all of us states to be good neighbors and to reduce the pollution that we are causing downwind. And so what the FIP does, the Good Neighbor Federal Implementation Plan, which is recently finalized by EPA, it makes several key improvements to the existing cross-state air pollution rule that Karen mentioned called CASPER, which is sort of an ozone season, summer ozone season, NOx limit in the form of an allowance budget with trading. It does several things to update that program. First, it establishes new near-term ozone season NOx limitations, NOx budgets, and then long-term, it incorporates a new mechanism called dynamic budgeting, where those quantitative limits on the total amount of NOx that can be emitted over the course of the ozone season in future years will be continuously updated as the power sector changes to ensure that those season-wide budgets remain current and effective and protective of public health while the electricity system changes over time. So that's a big improvement. Another thing, number two, that the Good Neighbor FIP does that we think is really important in Maryland is it establishes daily backstop NOx emission rates for facilities. And that's important because bad ozone days happen in the context of the ozone season, the summer ozone season, but they happen on specific days where we have high ozone. So as a complement to the season-wide NOx budgets, there needs to be some sort of measure looking at specifically those bad days. And that's what the daily backstop rate in the Good Neighbor FIP does. Is that it's set at a level for individual facilities that they would achieve if they simply run the controls they've already installed. And so it gives us some assurance that on the days that really count, the power plants are running their controls so that we're not having bad ozone days within a good ozone season. And the third thing it does is that it requires power plants that don't have modern controls to simply install modern cost-effective pollution controls, because it's 2023 and we all have to do that now. And the fourth thing that the rule does is that it expands coverage to non-EGUs. EGUs are power plants, electricity generating units. So the FIP establishes new standards for all sorts of other large stationary sources, industrial facilities, et cetera, based on ample research that shows that those sources are significant contributors to NOx pollution and ozone pollution, and that there are cost-effective reduction technologies available for them. So that's what the rule does. In terms of what Maryland thinks about it, as you probably could have guessed from my presentation, we're big fans in Maryland. Despite the fact that those of you who are good at maps and can read this EPA map showing what states they say are causing ozone pollution where, can see that Maryland is actually treated as an upwind state here. Not a downwind state who's having pollution inflicted upon us, but actually an upwind state who's contributing to non-attainment in Connecticut, where they're experiencing currently the worst ozone pollution on the East Coast. So that means that EPA disapproved our state implementation plan, imposed this federal implementation plan upon us, and I'm here to tell you we're thrilled about it. Nobody likes having a SIP disapproved, but in this case, this is a really good, strong program, correct move by EPA. They're going to require Maryland to walk the walk and do the things that we're telling all the states upwind of us that they have to do. So we have to demonstrate that we are being good neighbors to our neighbors to the Northeast, where we are enthusiastically taking on those obligations and requirements. We're taking them very seriously, and we're going to be good neighbors along with everyone else. And we're really looking forward to the clean air that this program will provide here in Maryland, but especially in areas downwind of us and everywhere else in the country. Looking forward to the discussion, Karen.
Thanks, Chris. Just one quick question before we move on to Elsie. Can you clarify a little bit about the relationship between this FIP and the cross-state air pollution rule? I mean, is this a FIP to comply with that, or is it additional? How are the two related? Are there other requirements under the cross-state air pollution rule that persist? And particularly, how do they differ, if they do differ, in the way flexible compliance is involved?
Sure. So this sort of updates the existing CASPER program, adds new requirements based on it, and is looking specifically for the 2015 ozone National Ambient Air Quality Standard. So it updates, modernizes, adds improvements. Under the Good Neighbor FIP, there is still flexible compliance, right? There are still compliance across the ozone season through the season-wide budgets, and there's compliance on daily emissions, because the plants have to sort of hit that limit, but they can hit that limit however, right? So there's still plenty of flexibility for how states and plants comply with the rule to make sure that they bring pollution down through whatever means prove most effective.
Great, thanks. Okay, Elsie, now let's hear about MATS.
Okay, great. Thank you so much, Karen. Is that looking okay? Excellent. Okay, so my name is Elsie Sunderland, and I'm a professor at Harvard University, and I've studied mercury pollution for many, many years. This is a somewhat storied regulation in that it began more than a quarter of a century ago under the Clinton administration. Everyone started thinking about the more than 200 different hazardous air pollutants. So HAP are a specific category of pollutant that are released when coal is combusted. So the original appropriate and necessary finding for the MATS rule that you heard about from Karen was actually in the year 2000, where EPA concluded that there was a plausible risk associated with mercury released from coal-fired utilities. And just a little tiny bit of background. So the rule does include many different hazardous air pollutants, but it's been focused on mercury. I don't know how many of you can remember the 1990s at this point, but mercury was really a pollutant of national importance at that time. Exposures to the organic form of mercury are associated with long-term developmental delays in children. Methylmercury is also associated with impaired cardiovascular health in adults. So this is a health concern. We did see it in the 1990s. We have monitoring data for the US population, and you see it somewhat ubiquitously in the population. And there were fish advisories and advisories for rivers and streams across the country, many of them still in place today. So one thing that you need to realize when in the context of these three rules is that the pathway for mercury exposure is mediated by aquatic environments. So it is released in two different chemical forms that I'm showing you in the slide. One of those chemical forms is deposited locally, and one of them is subject to long-range transport and deposited in further different long-range environments. Following emission, it has to be deposited to an aquatic environment, accumulate in fish, and then people consume that fish. So if you contrast the example of mercury with criteria air pollutants, I'm kind of glossing over many of the details, but it is complicated to quantitatively link this exposure pathway. So what I'll say today is that this is a story of wonderful regulatory success in terms of reducing domestic pollution. And it's the quantification around the benefits of those pollution reductions that have been problematic, and then how they hold up in court because of those challenges. So we're very good at quantifying the health benefits associated with criteria air pollutants, but we haven't been as good with mercury emissions. And so the residual risk and technology review is out now, as you know, and comments are due by the end of June. And I'm hoping in these few minutes to change your mind and give you some key pieces about this story. So I have to tell you a tiny bit of history, and I'll try not to be long-winded about it, but this slide is meant to re-emphasize for you what a success we've had in this country as part of the Clean Air Act amendments at reducing mercury pollution. The gold or yellow line is total domestic mercury emissions from 1990 to present. And the red line is the reduction in emissions from EGUs. And the background colors here are the criteria air pollutants that we have thought about and been very successful at attributing public health benefits to reductions in exposures to those pollutants. And then with mercury, again, because the exposure pathway isn't that direct inhalation pathway, but you have to also account for how it's transported into aquatic environments and then exposed to different population, it ends up being more complicated. So this is an area for work. I believe we can do this quite well. And you know, we've produced a number of documents that that sort of point in this direction. I think EPA is still, although the advances in the MATS rule, I think are wonderful, some of the dialogue in supporting those benefits aren't necessarily where they should have been. So just a couple points in history. So this is the 1990 Clean Air Act amendments, the first attempt to regulate mercury emissions predate MATS. This was the Clean Air Mercury Rule, where EPA regulated under an incorrect section of the Clean Air Act. And at that time, the coal-fired utilities were about 50% of domestic total emissions. The original MATS rule was promulgated in 2011. And we've seen relative to 2010 to 2020, more than a 90% reduction in total atmospheric deposition of mercury from that utility source. We heard earlier about the attempts. So basically what happened was with the regulatory impact analysis supporting that rule, because of the complicated exposure pathway, EPA was only able to quantify 4 to 6 million in direct benefits associated with the rule, and they characterized costs as around 8 to 10 billion. And what they advocated was that co-benefits would more than offset those costs. What we have found in subsequent work is that analysis was very incomplete. It didn't look at an appropriate fraction of the population, and it only considered IQ as a health endpoint. So we think that was a dramatic underestimate, and the costs and the benefits of the rule are actually, so the direct benefits of the rule are comparable to the costs upon reanalysis. So here we are under the Biden administration now, where the appropriate and necessary finding has been reaffirmed, and the residual risk and technology review has been presented. And actually, there has been a move to strengthen the existing rule under that RRTR. And I'll talk a little bit about that. This administration is really emphasizing environmental justice as an important concern. So this is something we've been looking at as part of this rule. This is something you can see in the RRTR as well. So again, when we think about mercury, we want to think about where are people who are most vulnerable to that local pollution from utilities. This slide is showing you the locations of the existing power plants in 2020. The pinkish color is showing the relative size of emissions in 2020 that remain. The green is showing the number of frequent fish consumers and different types of fish consuming populations across the country who may be more vulnerable to exposures. And then we've done a variety of analyses that bolster what EPA has put into the original RRTR that they just release. And what we find generally is that next to these power plants, you do see, so many have closed, but next to the active power plants, we do see that in general, there are lower socioeconomic status individuals residing next to the active power plants in 2020 compared to surrounding the regions of the plants that closed. And we also see just generally next to the power plants, siting related disparities. So you see more people of color, you see people with lower socioeconomic status and a greater proportion of high frequency fish consumers. So those environmental justice concerns, I think, are important and can be commented on in this rule. And the final component of thinking about this residual risk associated with remaining emissions. So I think I said it before, I didn't show you a slide for deposition, but we've got more than 90% reductions in domestic deposition from US coal-fired power plants across the country. So overwhelmingly, it's been incredibly positive. If you look at the fraction of total deposition remaining, so total mercury deposition remaining from US power plants, you don't see very many hotspots, but you do see these two darker purple regions pop out in North Dakota and in Texas. And so we were looking at this and finding this very interesting when the new rule came out. And actually, it's rare I feel this happy, but they proposed strengthening the rule specifically for lignite coal. And lignite coal in the US is mined. So the largest reserves globally, some of them are in North Dakota, and it's also mined in Texas. It's a type of virgin coal with low moisture content and low energy content, so it tends to be combusted immediately next to the sources. And it's, these are the only two regions where you really do see this large lignite coal combustion. So when MATS was promulgated initially, there were standards set for the other coal types that were very stringent, but basically weaker standards for the virgin types of coal. And this amended proposal will actually strengthen those rules. What we find is, you know, thinking about residual risk associated with mercury, there is a plausible risk still in those two regions whereby an individual could be exposed above the US EPA reference dose for methylmercury, solely attributable to existing emissions, but this standard should really fix that. And so this is wonderful news. And I think those proposed strengthening of those standards should be very much supported. So this is just a summary. Again, there are some EJ concerns around existing power plants that I think are important to emphasize and further support strengthening that rule. There is a plausible risk in those two locations still of exceeding the EPA reference dose for methylmercury, but this should be addressed if those controls are brought in line with everything else. And I've included a link on this slide if anyone is interested in looking more into the cost-benefit analysis discussion that I've kind of glossed over. So thank you so much.
Thanks, Elsie. Next, we're going to hear from Carrie Jenks about the Clean Power Plan.
So thanks so much for this. I am the executive director at Harvard Law's Environmental and Energy Law Program. I'll try to give a little background on how EPA had to walk into this rule. What's the statute that they're talking about, building on what Karen introduced, and then walk through the standards that they proposed. So Section 111, as Karen mentioned at the start, is the part of the Clean Air Act that requires EPA to set emission standards for power plants. And standards of performance are based on the degree of emission limit that's achievable through the best system of emission reduction, or BSER. And I think about it, and then BSER has three sort of components to it. One is whether the emission standard is based on a technology that's adequately demonstrated. EPA also considers energy and environmental impacts, as well as cost. And here, this last leg of the stool, or as I think about it, has been dramatically affected by Congress when they enacted the IRA. And so I think what's remarkable of where we are today is because of this, the incentives that are included, including CCS incentives and hydrogen incentives, EPA really had different components that they could think about as they walked into this rulemaking. At the same time, as Karen mentioned, EPA also had to consider the Supreme Court decision, West Virginia versus EPA. Two things to keep in mind for that decision. One, I think it did reinforce EPA's authority to regulate greenhouse gas emission reductions. Rather, it did constrain, though, how EPA could regulate it. And the question before the court was whether the court characterized the Clean Power Plan as putting a cap on emissions emissions from the power sector and using generation shifting to set the standards. And the court rejected those last two points. But they still said that EPA should set the standards and then states for existing sources have to implement and enforce those standards. So where we are today is we're just at this first step where EPA is proposing the level of pollution that EPA proposes should be reduced from power plants. Then EPA has to finalize that rule and then states kick in for the existing sources. So going with that, where are we for the standards? I think of them as three buckets, three components of this rule. There's the existing source standards for coal, the new gas standards, and then the existing gas standards. And for each of those buckets, there's a bunch of different tiers that I'll walk through. But generally, I think the principle EPA had in mind as they started to set these standards is that if your baseload, meaning you're operating a lot in a year, and you're going to do that for the foreseeable future beyond 2040, for example, the standards require those large plants to really control their emissions. And I'll talk through how in a minute. Another point, though, that I think EPA heard from various industry was that the energy sector is in a transition. They're doing that for market reasons. They're doing that because of some of the regs you just heard. And they're doing that for customer reasons and stakeholder engagement and state regs as well. And so some of these units are uneconomic to run far into the future, and they're planning to retire them. And so they're planning to run less, and this grid is changing as that happens. And so a lot of industry asked EPA to take that into consideration as they started to set these standards. So starting with coal, as I mentioned, there's several options. So if a coal unit is going to operate beyond 2040, then they're asking those plants to install CCS at 90% capture rate by 2030. However, if the plant is going to retire by 2040, then you can co-fire with natural gas, 40%, and you start that in 2030. If you're retiring by 2035, then you could operate less than 20% capacity limit, and you would meet your historic emission rate. And then if you're retiring by 2032, then you just need to continue your emission rate at that level. So 2030 is really where the gas standards for existing coal kick in. For new gas, there's three different subcategories within this bucket of standards, and there's a various phases. So it gets a little bit more complicated. A new gas plant can be built today, and if it's intending to operate as a baseload gas plant, then it needs to meet efficiency standards in the first phase. By 2032, though, by 2031, I would say, they have to decide which path they're going to take if they're going to operate as baseload. They either need to install and operate CCS by 2035, or there's the option to blend hydrogen at varying levels in 2032 and 2038. So they can do either option. For intermediate units, those that are operating between 20% capacity up to about 40 to 55%, then you would meet a different heat rate in the first phase. And the second phase starts in 2032, where you'd have to blend 30% hydrogen and meet an emission limit based on that. Peaking units, you could operate less than 20% capacity, and then you'd meet a standard that's pretty consistent with the standard that's in today, which is a lower emitting fuel standard. But 2031 is where a new gas plant that's built now would have to decide which path they're taking. For existing gas plants, they took a different approach in that they're only regulating large baseload units. So they define that as a unit that's greater than 300 megawatts and or operating above 50% capacity factor. But then the standard is similar to what they've got for new gases, same timeline. You can either meet CCS by 2035 or blend 30% and 96% in those two respective years. One last slide, because I mentioned that the states have a role more for existing sources. The statute also says that states, when they set the plans and design the plans to implement and enforce the standards, also can consider remaining useful life and other factors. So it's this new acronym, RULOF. And EPA, though, has said, what EPA's role is to set the national standard. And then there may be situations, case by case, where that standard is not appropriate. And EPA said examples of where it may not be appropriate for that unit to meet the standard is if it's unreasonable cost of control, meaning the tons of CO2 reduced is dramatically different. The cost of reducing that CO2 is dramatically different for that unit, or it's either physically impossible or technically infeasible. But generally, EPA is saying it has to be a fundamentally different determination than what they've set for the presumptive BSER. The other point to keep in mind is that states do have flexibility in how they decide to implement this for their sources. And their EPA is requesting comment on how a rate-based trading program could work to ensure equivalency. They're requesting comment on whether a mass-based approach could work. And they're including components that Chris was talking about dynamic budgeting. And they're also requesting comments on banking and interstate trading, because to the extent states are already in some programs for greenhouse gases where they're working with other states, EPA is asking how those types of programs might be there. And then finally, EPA also makes clear that there's an obligation of states, consistent with its other regulations they've recently proposed, that they have to provide meaningful engagement as part of the state plan for existing coal plants and existing gas plants. And they're specifically making sure that community members, where there's an existing fossil unit that might be installing CCS or hydrogen, have an opportunity to weigh in on how that technology would be deployed and what it would mean for that community. So just stepping back, I think it's important to remember this is a proposal. It expects a 60-day comment period once it's published in the Federal Register. And there's a lot of areas for comment. EPA's proposed variations on what I just walked through and asking for different feedback on the different cutoffs and how much existing gas might be subject to the rule. They're asking for information about cost. And then they're also thinking through and want information about how to support states that need to think through what their options are and how these flexibilities might work. But I'll stop there and welcome questions.
Thanks, Carrie. So three great presentations. I guess I want to start with a question for Elsie about those health benefits that EPA hasn't traditionally quantified, and I believe didn't quantify in the RIA of the new proposal as well. Could you talk a bit more about what we know there and how those kinds of health benefits might compare to the things that EPA did quantify in its RIA?
Yeah, that's a great question. So the original RIA promulgated in 2011, as I mentioned, only quantified direct benefits for the children of recreational anglers in the country. So they didn't consider the broad population exposures to mercury, which would really bolster the benefits numbers. And they only considered the health endpoint of IQ, so a morbidity, instead of cardiovascular disease, which is mortality. And if you're in the economic world, then morbidity is worth a lot less, and IQ point is only worth, 10 to 14,000 points versus, many millions for the statistical value of life. So this is part of, I think, what went wrong initially in the amended appropriate and necessary finding that was reaffirmed. EPA did a broader screening analysis. We commented extensively on what we thought were still some areas for improvement in the revised analysis, but they did push their benefits numbers up past, it had a range, but it was hundreds of millions to more than $1 billion. And at the same time, costs had come down. They didn't put any benefits analyses numbers, so direct benefit numbers, in the risk and technology review, residual risk and technology review that just came out in April, even though a screening analysis was included in the ANN finding. And they emphasized instead the co-benefits again for criteria air pollutants. And those are, as they have been all along, in the, 30 plus billion range. So they're very large, and they certainly are much greater than any costs. The legal challenges have come around the direct benefits and costs, though. So I think there is room for improvement, and asking for those numbers is important. The most important thing is really the numbers of people considered, so broadly considering the population exposed and that mortality endpoint.
Great, thank you so much. Carrie, you alluded a little bit in your presentation to this, the legal history around EPA regulation of CO2 emissions. I think there seems to be an emerging consensus that the new version of the regulation under 111 is a stronger legal ground than the Clean Power Plan. Would you agree with that? And if or not, would you comment on that?
Yeah, I mean, I think they're on a they've really taken a different approach than what they did in the Clean Power Plan, because it's much more consistent with how EPA has used 111 in the past. It's more of a technology standard. It's not trying to say, the grid needs to look like X in a future year. They're saying, what can be done to each plant to reduce emissions? And then is it cost effective and possible? And so it's more of a traditional approach. And I think that gives people comfort that that EPA is staying within its lane in a way that is possible. I think it's also going to be important, though, to see how comments come in. And that this is a proposal and there's a lot of options. So EPA is going to need to take comment, and states and stakeholders need to give feedback to EPA so that they've got the grounding on these different bases.
Great. So, Chris, one topic that came up in your presentation, it comes up in the Good Neighbor Plan and also in 111, is this idea of dynamic budgeting. Could you say a little bit more about how that works and how it might be relevant in both places?
Sure. Well, when you're setting something like an emissions budget really far into the future, that gets really hard, right? Because the future is very uncertain. And so you do your best to set sort of the right number. But then, of course, the world keeps on spinning and things change. So dynamic budgeting effectively just means that they'll check and update that number as time goes on. Now, in the Good Neighbor FIP, that's sort of phased in relatively far from now, right? The near-term budgets are set, they are certain. But I think it's an important tool to ensure that rules stay current and don't sort of sit on the shelf and get stale as things change, anticipated or otherwise, that can render, you know, any specific number you put in a regulation then sort of irrelevant as time goes on. So dynamic budgeting makes sure that things stay current and stay effective. And so the way EPA will do it is that they'll look at actual outcomes over prior years once they're, you know, doing the dynamic budgeting for future years' budgets. And they'll look at what has actually happened and simply recalibrate that budget to ensure that it's in line with the intended purpose of the rule.
Right. That this topic of dynamic budgeting brings up the issue of that applies to both those these regulations, flexibility and compliance. And I wonder, Carrie, if as people look at the various options that EPA's put in the 111 proposal, how should they think about the use of cap and trade, and specifically the existing cap and trade programs that are out there, in light of ideas around dynamic budgeting, the fact that you've got these standards sort of tailored to different types of plants and somebody drops out, and that has really big implication for what the budget should be. So any thoughts on that?
Yeah, so because EPA has taken a more traditional approach to this rulemaking, it's not looking at the cap from the federal program and the cap from the state program, and as long as the state is more stringent than its equivalent or better, it's not as easy to compare. It doesn't mean you can't compare it, but I think it's going to take more engagement from states to look at their fleet. What do they expect their fleet to look like in the future years? Decide what is that emission rate that applies to that unit, and then decide, does it make sense to aggregate those emissions within that subcategory and say, we think, you know, averaging across existing gas plants that are subject to this rule is more cost effective. But I would also say for states that are in RGGI, for example, you know, they've got a cap. So is that cap actually doing the work, or is the standard doing the work? So it's going to take more analysis and engagement and talking through, now that we have all these details, to think through what does it mean to states. So it's not as easy sort of plug and play, but at the same time, I think it doesn't take things off the table either. I expect to see some opportunities where some trading or averaging will make sense to some states.
Great. Well, Elsie, in the case of the MATS proposal, there, as I understand it, EPA has a preferred emission rate standard, and that is for, I believe, the mostly applies to the other kind of HAPs. It's like the particulate, and then they have a tighter, a as proposed standard that they want people to comment on, that's 40% tighter, basically. So it's like 0.01 down to 0.006. Can you give us a sense of how to think about that? Is that a significant improvement? Does it have really big, potentially really big benefits on the environmental side? And anything you could say about costs as well would be helpful.
Yeah, it's difficult for me to comment on costs.
Okay.
With that. But as I said, you know, during the presentation, I think basically EPA is bringing the standards uniformly in line for all coal types across the country, which are very stringent. And in areas, so generally we've seen successful reductions in emissions of all different types of pollutants as a result of the original rule. And this will strengthen, as I showed for mercury, those last remaining areas. And I think that's kind of the key point of the strengthening of the regulation, is that we will, in the areas where there still are some remaining concerns, this rule will bring up those standards and bring us in line with that. It's, I think, because the rule has been so overwhelmingly successful, it's important to think about that from an environmental justice lens, perhaps more so than just a dollars lens and numbers of people. So is it fair that certain communities aren't being protected as stringently because of the locations of these different source types? And I think that's something that EPA has started to address in the proposed rule, and I think is important to support in the comment period.
Right. In the graph that you showed, there was a big declines after 2005 in mercury emissions. Can you say a little bit about what contributed to that?
Sure. That's a great example, because the first ever rule to regulate mercury emissions that stuck is in 2011, but the first attempt at this under the wrong section of the Clean Air Act was in 2005. It was regulated under Section 111. So HAPs were regulated under Section 111 instead of 112. A lot of the states were very supportive of that rule and started to aggressively regulate internally. And then, of course, because EPA proposed under Section 111 to have a cap and trade strategy for mercury, but there are, you know, because of the different chemical forms of mercury, there's a plausible local residual risk around the utility, then it's inappropriate to regulate under Section 111. So you can't have a cap and trade strategy if there is a potential for, you know, adverse exposure of a local population. But we did see the benefit of that proposal in terms of declines in emissions around those years, because we were moving toward a regulation that wasn't successful. I think this is an important point to keep in mind when we compare different time periods and what are the benefits of this regulation, because that false start actually was successful at reducing emissions domestically. And then, our baseline for comparison now becomes a period after which we've already had some pretty substantial reductions. So how we do the bean counting is actually really important. And this can have impacts because, of course, the legal discussion ends up being, what are the public health benefits? And I think it's, what are the public health benefits relative to what initial time period? I should, I personally think we should be comparing 1990, you know, when the Clean Air Act was amended, as the baseline period to present. And then you really see the success of these rules. But the very narrow definitions and time windows for MATs usually present other periods, which lower the benefits numbers that we see. So they are much higher if you look to those earlier periods.
Right. That's a benefit of the kind of graphs you're showing that show the history. So there's a question about the way that these rules relate to recent congressional activities. Like, how do you think the passage of the IRA affects the ability of the the Good Neighbor Rule to be successful, or the CPP to be successful. The rule that needs to have a short name so it's easy to talk about in a webinar. could you comment a little bit about how you think the IRA, I mean, Carrie, you talked a little bit about costs, but any other reflections about that, Chris or Carrie?
You want to go first?
Okay, sure. I'll try. So for Good Neighbor, it's sort of less direct than the 111 rule, since the IRA sort of specifically changed the cost calculus for what the 111 rule is considering, and not as much for Good Neighbor. But the influence it's going to have on the power sector and sort of improvement increases in clean energy generally are, of course, only positive influences from the perspective of sort of outside the rule into the rule in terms of, you know, where we get our energy and sort of, you know, getting it from places that don't have the same pollution challenges that things like the Good Neighbor FIP are designed to manage. So it only makes the sort of the entire enterprise easier. But 111, it is really that Congress clearly intended that these technologies be deployed more by putting a lot of funding behind them. And then that specifically changes the cost picture for the power plants that'll be implementing this and therefore the determination of the SCR. So it's very helpful, and it makes sense that the government is coming at, you know, stepping outside the role of a regulator, it makes sense that the government is coming at this problem from different directions, right? Through direct incentives and tax policies, and also through direct regulation. It's a huge problem. Climate change is an enormous problem that we face, and it makes sense that the government is deploying all available tools to address it, especially in economically beneficial ways, like these regulations and direct incentives.
Yeah, I think if you look at the regulatory impact analysis also that EPA released with these proposals, you see the IRA doing a lot of the work in terms of the emission reductions and the technology deployment. The EPA's proposal does somewhat more, but the IRA, because of the cost incentives, are really trying to create the incentives for companies to deploy this technology. And as Chris said, EPA then is saying, okay, you know, we do think that these technologies will be deployed and can be deployed. I think adequately demonstrated doesn't mean that everybody's already done it. It means that it is possible to do it. And so but it was prior to the IRA going to be very costly to do so. And so the IRA really changed that. It sort of moved the game pieces on the board for EPA to really start to think differently about what was possible within the power sector, given the cost shifts that happened.
So
Can I follow up on one of the, and put a finer point on one of the things that Carrie just said about how the SCR doesn't depend on the technology already being used everywhere. Like, the entire point of air regulations and the Clean Air Act is take technology that's not being used everywhere, but is adequately demonstrated, and make it be used more, right? So if it were already being used everywhere, we wouldn't need a regulation. The entire purpose and function of the Clean Air Act is to expand the use of these technologies that meet these criteria in order to reduce pollution. So the fact that they're not already being used in lots of places is by definition like the purpose of the exercise here, right? So it's not sort of a vulnerability of the rule. It's the core function of the entire program.
Okay. So question about what the new rule means for gas generation. So we've talked a lot for years about coal with CCS, but now EPA is looking at gas with CCS or hydrogen blending for at least some gas plants. So a question about whether standard NGC gas plants will have to install CCS in the 20s or 30s. I think this was sort of answered in your chart, but are there any further considerations here with respect to gas that EPA is kind of missing in this rule? Or
yeah, I guess I would add a couple points to keep in mind. EPA is setting performance standards. So to be clear, I probably wasn't as clear. They're setting an emission rate based on what they think the best technology is, but a company can do whatever it wants to achieve that standard. So the best system of emission reduction is CCS, but they're also giving, because companies are asking for it, the option to also use hydrogen instead. And some of that's based on what's physically possible, what companies' business plans are. So you see some companies making investments and installing CCS on their gas plants. You see other companies really leaning into the hydrogen, given the funding that's available from the IRA, as well as the bipartisan bill that was passed earlier. So I think EPA is trying to be responsive to say, you have to make sure you control your emissions if you're operating a base load with either of these technology options that companies are looking at.
Okay, thanks. So a question about compliance monitoring, Chris, particular to the good neighbor rule. And are there going to be new capabilities for monitoring that are going to be required as the U.S. transitions to green energy adoption? Like what, what observing capabilities most support compliance monitoring?
Yeah, so the good news is for something like the good neighbor FIP, where we're talking about a very well known and easily measured pollutant from a sort of easily measured context, a smokestack, right? Where we simply have continuous emissions monitors that we put inside the smokestack that continuously measure the pollution that comes out. It's sort of very easy to see, okay, are you compliant or not, right? And then that factors into some very clear thresholds like the daily backstop rate and very transparent compliance mechanisms like an allowance trading program. So the good news is that for sort of like the nitty gritty of implementing the rule, it's you know, the existing technology works very well, but it factors into sort of the broader environmental justice effort. New monitoring technology factors into a broader environmental justice challenge and our solutions to that challenge, where we now have low cost air monitors that can be deployed at scale in communities. And we're beginning to see this in many places, including in Maryland, where we can set up community level air monitoring networks so that we can understand that sort of outside of the regulation that's applying at technology level at power plants, what's the actual impact on the ground and how does that impact vary in different communities so that we can really understand in communities overburdened by pollution quantitatively, what does that mean? And then we can turn that information into what to do about it. And so stepping outside of this sort of these traditional Clean Air Act mechanisms that were established by a 50-year-old law, we can now use this new technology to take new approaches beyond those regulations to address environmental injustices in particular communities in a way that we weren't able to before because we didn't have this new air monitoring technology. So it's a really promising area to do new things and to serve what is sort of the moral imperative of environmental regulation, which is addressing much more local impacts in overburdened communities.
Good point, yeah. So EPA, as I said, it's been a very busy spring, and there was even another regulation impacting coal plants that I believe was announced earlier this week, which the proposed coal combustion residual disposal facilities and general coal ash management rule. What do you think this additional regulation means for coal generation in the U.S. and how do we think about these regulations as a collective? Is this adding more incentives to reduce coal generation in the U.S., contributing to the energy transition? What's the way to think about this? Anyone want to comment? Terry?
I think about it in looking at what companies are announcing about their coal plants. A lot of companies and states are already planning to retire their coal plants, and they're expecting to retire them in the near future. The question is, what is that timing? And so the way I look at each rule is, does this rule change what a company is already deciding to do? Does it make them move it earlier? I think what's important, and Elsie was getting at it, and Chris was mentioning it also, it encourages companies and requires companies to start to think through, does it make sense to make another investment decision in this coal plant, or does it make more sense to make an investment in a new plant and a new resource? And so those are decisions companies are always making. EPA is one fact. EPA's regs, whether it be CCR or MATS or Good Neighbor or 111 power rules, is one factor, but there's also state regulations, there's cost of fuel, there's market dynamics. So it's one more component into it, but none of these, I think, and it in and of itself changes, is the only reason a company is making these decisions. But I think it's consistent with where the power sector is going on a whole.
Any other comments? Go, Chris.
Well, can I add, and this has been mentioned before, but EPA sort of is deliberately doing all of these things together so that everyone can see the whole picture all at once. It's very helpful for state regulators, for power plant operators to know, all right, these are the different programs across different media that we have to plan for all at once, rather than there being an error rule, you know, for one pollutant this year, next year, an error rule for a different pollutant 2 years later, a rule that's not even air, it's water related. And then there's continuously changing, you know, requirements. Instead, EPA deliberately sort of has been trying to do all these things together so that everybody can plan for them all at once. That's very helpful. It's going to be a workload issue for us because now we have a bunch of homework to do all at once, but it's definitely the best way to do it. And in terms of how they all, you know, work together, I mean, I'm interested to see the analysis that your organizations will do where you pull everything together and give us all an expectation of what do they all add up to outside of their individual impacts.
Great. So with respect to, you mentioned investments, Carrie, and with respect to 111, recognizing that plants can do whatever they want, but to actually achieve emission reductions using CCS, for example, there's a lot of infrastructure that's going to need to be developed. And I'm just wondering how that impacts the decisions about adequately demonstrated, or what additional things the government's going to have to do or is doing to help make that feasible, in addition to the tax credits.
Yeah, I think, you know, we know how to capture CO2. We understand the technology, it's been done, people can do this, but the infrastructure that you mentioned, whether it be pipelines to move the CO2, the transmission lines to connect new plants to the grid, all of that is the infrastructure that is ongoing and is a challenge independent and regardless of any of these EPA regulations. So I think it is a component that's going to be critical to part of the discussion. I don't know that EPA in and of itself is not going to fix permitting and the permitting reform that's being discussed by Congress or the transmission lines that are trying to be built across state lines. I think there's various components that we can talk about in the rule where EPA is recognizing that challenge. They're working with DOE and FERC. And then states also have remaining useful life and other factors, that new acronym RULOF, so that if a plant, for example, intends to install CCS, but for some reason can't do it because a permitting process has been delayed by a state or whatever the process is, then states have that discretion to go case by case to say, here, you know, this unit needs more time to do X, Y, and Z. So I do think there are different options, but this is the first step of that process where EPA is just trying to define what is best system of emission reduction. And then, you know, we keep moving down this path.
So we've talked a bit about court challenges to 111. Do we expect the other rules to be tied up with court challenges? I guess it's particularly for the FIP. Are there potential issues there or with the Mercury proposal that anyone wants to comment on?
Well, I'll let one of the lawyers weigh in. As a non-lawyer, you know, everything EPA does gets challenged in court, of course. And sometimes we're the ones challenging. I think when we look at something like the Good Neighbor FIP, it's a very well-constructed rule, and it's pointing to very well-demonstrated cost-effective technologies and control measures that are, for example, almost all already in place in places like Maryland. So I mean, our opinion is that one's on very strong legal footing, but their challenges are inevitable.
Yeah, there's already challenges to the, when EPA issues the FIP, they first have to deny the SIPs. And so there's always already challenges in the courts on the EPA's actions to deny the SIPs, and those are ongoing.
Got it.
And then I expect once the Good Neighbor Rule is published in the Federal Register, I think people are anticipating entities will challenge that rule as well, which is the FIP. I think there's no doubt everyone has heard about all the Clean Power Plan and ACE litigation, but CARE and SIP and CASPER, CARE, Good Neighbor, all of those have a long litigation history as well. I don't think we've had any one transport rule that hasn't been litigated and gone back and forth. So no doubt this will end up in the courts. At the same time, I think The good neighbor rule is based on the same legal structure they've done, EPA has done over and over again, that the DC circuit has told them they have to do and tweaking on the edges. So I think it's a strong rule based on the case law.
Great, great. So I think I wanna move towards giving everybody a chance to say one last thing about the rule or something that you'd like to leave the panel, the audience with. And then we'll wrap up. So, Elsie, would you like to go first?
Sure, I'll just touch on your last question and point with respect to the Mercury rule and reiterate what I think is the most important thing about that rule, which is the regulatory actions have just been an incredible success. And if we can close some of the holes in the science and in the impact assessment, then I think you have a legally very strong case and rule. And I think it's in the, you know, these other rules I think are newer. In the case of Mercury, I think that the research is there, the data is there, and these comments are really important for pushing EPA to put their best foot forward in having a legally strong rule. And I think we can do that at this point. So I feel quite encouraged about it, unlike some other areas of my work. So thank you.
Thanks. Chris, how would you like to go next?
I mean, it's a very exciting time. Speaking from a state's perspective, having a supportive federal partner in pollution reduction and addressing climate change and air quality is just hugely important, and it's extremely encouraging, and things are, you know, going to move in the right direction, and we all need to keep on pushing and supporting these regulations that work and that will you know, give us clean air and mitigate the impacts of climate change. It's very, very, very exciting time.
Thanks, Chris. And Carrie?
Yeah, I guess I'll add to my last point. I think everyone keeps asking all of us if the Supreme Court's going to strike down these new rules that don't have an acronym. And I guess I have 2 points. One, you know, we never know what the Supreme Court's going to do, but at the same time, it's a proposal. So we definitely don't know what they will do until we know what EPA finalizes. I think it's also the very reason why stakeholders need to work with EPA, because they put their best out, you know, ideas out there for feedback, and they always are going to refine it, whether it be for the power sector, greenhouse gas regs or MATS, and they're trying to figure out what is the best way to land. And they may, invariably, you always see some tweaks and changes based on what stakeholders say, new ideas come to light, and good ideas come to light. And so EPA will want to be able to understand what those, what makes sense to finalize these rules. But I also think there are a bunch of rules going to be finalized in another year or so, and the court does not hear every single EPA rule that ever gets finalized. So it's also important to think through whether the court, which rules the court decides to pick up, the Supreme Court, and which ones they decide are not precedential and they don't want to take them up. So there's another piece of uncertainty of whether even the court will take any of these rules up that I think is important to keep in mind as well.
Great, thank you so much. We've reached the end of our session. And so at this point, I'm gonna bring this panel to a close by thanking all of you for joining us today and for your thoughtful questions. The event was recorded and can be rewatched in full at rff.org, where you can also find more information about subscribing to our content and supporting RFF. Finally, thanks to our wonderful speakers, Chris, Carrie, and Elsie. Thanks again, and everyone have a great day. Bye-bye.